resurrected Lord Jesus.
And it's with great anticipation that I look forward to this night of service, trusting that somehow, in some way, that our Heavenly Father will smile His blessing to us. And ever so often I get an opportunity to get in to have these services here in the church with the group, you little group that the members here of the church and the visitors, of course. And this was not announced. It was just a regular Wednesday night prayer meeting, and I said maybe tonight we'd find out whether they're coming back. And I thought if we'd take it over and maybe announce it for the next week, why it would, we can't see too many people here. And these type of services, if God willing, is not directed to the, it's directed to the church for the benefit of the church, where we feel that it's so greatly needed at the time. Everywhere is to for the edifying of the body of Christ. And now this, in teaching, I've had the healing services for 8 years straight. And then teaching is going to be kind of something new. And I was thinking this afternoon when I opened the Bible after being very busy through the day, I thought, well, I told the people I teach on the seven church ages, maybe if the Lord willing. I got to reading and just got that real happy when I started reading it. And I thought, well, I can take all that in one night, an hour. So I didn't know what the Holy Spirit would have us to do. We don't try to set anything. It's just, if it be thy will, Lord. See, that's the best. And then, if it be the will of the Lord, I'd like to teach tonight on the church ages, and tomorrow night on the mark of the beast, and the next night on the seal of God. And that, and then Saturday, our brother janitor was just telling me today, he said if they had it Saturday night, Sunday morning, usually when the strangers come in to our midst, why, the church should be very dirty and so forth, so they suggested just have Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, and Sunday morning, Sunday night. And I said, well, that would be perfectly all right as far as I was concerned. So then we'll try, if the Lord willing, have it Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Sunday morning, and Sunday night. And perhaps Sunday night we may have a baptismal service, as people have already been asking about being baptized. And so now, and we'll try every night to begin just on time at 7:30, and I get the platform by 8 o'clock. We ought to be evacuated from the tabernacle by 9:30, the Lord willing. So it's you, I know you work, and we have respect to that. And now, these little messages out of the book of Revelations are directed to the church. And I wish everyone would bear this in mind, that they're not directed towards anybody's religion or any other motive, only just, to my best of my knowledge, to the reading and explaining of the Word of God. See, it's not put through any selfish motive, or it's not directed towards anybody, any individual, or anybody's church, anybody's religion. And the reason that I like to teach on this revelation here at the tabernacle, being my own church, well, I just feel like I'm home, and I just, you know, kind of give my sheep the kind of diet that I thought they needed. You know, some people sometimes have to put a little salt in when the alfalfa is a little moldy, you know. It might hurt the sheep if you don't. So once in a while, when maybe the alfalfa gets a little moldy around the church, and a little difference has come up, so I think a little salt kind of is a savior, don't you think so?
Amen.
It kind of keeps them from getting sick. So now we pray that God will bless us in these efforts. And how many just feeling just as men and women like we are, I would like to look into that tomorrow night on what is the mark of the beast. There's so much about it in the Bible. Who has it? Who will have it? And then the next, there's coming a time where that's going to be, and I don't know, it may be now. We'll look and see. Yeah? That there's going to be only two classes of people on the earth. And one's going to be marked with the devil, and the other in the mark of God. And I think that if we're nearing into that time, we better kind of go to looking around and find out what that thing is, because it certainly isn't going to come in only some great big something. If the Bible said it would slip in so easy that it would deceive the very elect if it were possible. So we'll try, if God willing, to look to it tomorrow night. Now that's just the best. Bring your Bible along and your pencil and paper. You want to take down scriptures, and you just don't think that's just exactly right, write me a little note and put it on for the next time. I remember staying a year and 6 months in this book of Revelation and the tabernacle here. That's what I like in teaching. I just love teaching. Oh, my. I think it's wonderful. It gives the basis and settles the church in preaching. Now, there's some people that are preachers. They can pick up the word with inspiration and sway it out there in places. That's watering the seeds that the teacher has taught. See? Now, you've got to put some seed in first and then water. And the watering comes from the preaching of the word. There's a great, vast difference between a teacher and a preacher. See? It's two different gifts of the Spirit all together, two different gifts. And I humbly say this, but I haven't the gift of either. But mine, as of usual, is praying for the sick. That's what the Lord called me to do. And then in this time, it gives a relaxation of my mind to study on something different, not having divine healing services, just teaching the Word. And, oh, we get along pretty good here. I remember you put up with me for a long time, about 12 years around here on it. And I used to say, with not meaning it for a joke, but the teaching is so rough, I said, it's just like a fellow going to the table and eating the cornbread and beans. Now, it's good for you, but you get a little tired of it once in a while. You might have something on the side, some ice cream and cake once in a while, but it kind of balances up the diet. But the good old-fashioned stuff will stick with you pretty good, and at least it gives you some starter. Now, in this, it's to my humble belief that we are living in the closing days of the world's history. I want to make that real clear. Now, I could be wrong. I don't know. No one else knows. Jesus said not even the angels of heaven would know. He didn't know himself. He said that's only for the Father, the only one who knows. But it's sure and authentic that he is returning, and I just can't see anything else left but the coming of the Lord. When I look and see the nations broke, I see politics broke, I see the homes broke, I see the church broke. There's just nothing else can mend it but God, that's all. Because they have nothing else. The morals of the nations broke. And the political parties are broken. Or we trusted so much in our politics, they're broke. And some great fellow in England not long ago said, well, democracy was all sails and no anchor. That said, there'd come a time that to be on soapboxes lectioneering. Well, that's true, but he didn't think of his own beloved house of the Lord's eye. It was a lot of sails, no anchor to it. Flew away also, and every kingdom of this world will be broke to pieces. Amen. Jesus Christ will rule and reign.
Amen.
So there's, my hopes is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
Amen.
All around my soul gives way. He's all my hope and faith. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other grounds is sinking sand. And, oh, how I wish now we start in for about a 3 month teaching service so you can get to the book of Revelations and tie it in with Daniel, the great vision, How many's left in the little flock here that used to remember when I had the old chart across here? I know Brother Head was. We had several years when he had the old chart. Now the book of Revelation's how it's made up, and Daniel ties in with it, Isaiah ties in with it, all the Old Testament ties in with it, and it's the book of the revelation of Jesus Christ. The book of the revelation of Jesus Christ. And then in there, there's seven churches, seven plagues, seven seals, seven trumpets. Now, a trumpet represents war. A seal, a mystery unfolding. And a plague is what follows every war. And by God's help and with the book of history, I can prove to you that we're living at the seventh trumpet for the seventh plague and the seventh seal to be opened and the seventh vial to be poured out. When the sixth one sounds, we'll get on that maybe the sealing away on Friday night. When the First World War, while that sixth trumpet sounded exactly according to the time God spoke of it, exactly geographically following the seal before that, and when the mystery was revealed in there for the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and the people then, how the church did not move up, and those who were moving refused to walk in light and went back, and the plague was opened at that time and poured out upon the earth, which was influenza that killed all the people, as it did the thousands times thousands, and then coming down into this last age where we are here, and just come and listen what the Lord has to say about in His Word. Now, that isn't my makeup. I'm just be reading it like a newspaper right out of the Word of God.
Amen.
So, this is His direct revelation to the church. To the church. The revelation of Jesus Christ to the church. Now, before we speak to Him or speak of His writing, let us bow our heads and speak to Him just a moment in a word of prayer. Our kind Heavenly Father, as we solemnly bow our heads to the dust whence we were taken and shall return someday if Thou dost tarry, we bow in humility to ask that You will be near us tonight to bless us. I can lay back the pages of this Bible, but there's no man that's able to open the book or to loose the seals thereof. And it's written in here, he that takes out of this shall be taken out of his part of the book of life, and who adds to it, the plagues of God will be poured out upon him. Father, realizing his mortal man and women sitting here tonight, knowing that we're an eternity-bound people, God, may the Holy Spirit come, the writer of this Bible, and open up these pages to us. And may Thy humble and profitable servant preach as a dying man to dying man, as if this would be the last service I'd ever have this side of eternity. The last night we'd ever gather together, and may every one of the laity act tonight as if this was their last sermon they'd ever hear. God, take away all folly. Make us sincere, knowing that we must answer at the judgment of God someday. And our attitude towards Him and His Word now will determine our eternal destination. So, Father, with trembling hearts, we come to Thee and ask, let the Lord Jesus in the form of the Holy Spirit take the Word of God tonight and give it to every heart as we have need. For we ask it in His name. Amen. It just may seem a little strange to me for a few moments now in trying to start opening up a subject to teach, because it's always been on divine healing for the last few years, and then not on prophecy, by no means, and then go right into a prayer line. But now, tonight, we want to get the background of the book that we're asking God to open for us. That's the book of the revelation of Jesus Christ. This book was wrote about AD 96, according to the writers. And it was John the Beloved, and he had this vision on the Isle of Patmos, an isle in the Aegean Sea, about 15 miles or something around it in circumference, a real rocky place full of serpents and so forth, where the Roman nation used it as an Alcatraz, as we would have it today, a place of exile of criminals that the government could not control. And this book was wrote by the last one of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, believed to be the Beloved that leaned on his bosom after the resurrection. And he said, "What is it to thee if he tarry till I come?" John died an old man. Every one of the martyrs sealed their testimony with their own blood. John, his destiny was met like this. He was caught and boiled in a vat of grease for 24 hours of hot boiling grease, and without any harm coming to him. And they put him on the isle, as commonly believed, as a witch. He would bewitch the grease so it wouldn't burn him, they said. Of course, it was the power of God. Amen. That you can't borrow the Holy Spirit out of a man. Why? So they tried to boil it out of him, but God wouldn't permit it. And he had a work for him to do, and until God was finished with his man, there's nothing in the world can bother him. That's all.
Amen.
Now, John being old, they are told by historians that he was brought to the church to preach, and he was so old, the only thing he would say was, "Little children, love one another."
Amen.
I tell you, that's a very good thing to preach on. Little children, love one another. As I get older in the ministry now, in my 21st year, I think all the time as I go along that this, the more I think of the Lord Jesus, the more I begin to find out that it's love that covers the whole thing.
Amen.
The love of God shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit. Now, we'll just read a few verses here to get started, and then we'll go right into the teaching of the church, and then try to bring it to a place of God willing in this much time that I have to get it over to where we can get in, to where we can pick up the mark of the beast for tomorrow night. Now, this is to the church. Now, I'm going to try to get at least the church of Ephesus, the first church, and the last church that we're living in now, the church of the Laodiceans. Now, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which shortly come to pass. And he sent his angel and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. Now, the scripture gives us a start here. It is a revelation, or the word revelation means something that's revealed. The revelation of Jesus Christ given to John, and an angel was sent to bear record, or to signify it. And he bare record of the word of God, and of the testimony of Jesus Christ, and of the things which he saw. Blessed is he that readeth. How many would like to have a blessing? Then readeth. See, he that readeth, blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of the prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand.
Amen.
In other words, not the time at hand then, but the time is at hand when they see this word being completed.
Amen.
When the complete revelation, when God started off like an artist drawing a picture of something, he begins to fill in his parts. You can begin to see its shape up. And as you begin at the first of the book of Revelation, you see Jesus Christ begin to come into the picture, and at the last of it, you see him complete, seated with his church, glorified. All the days of sin and trouble and temptations are over, and Christ is seated with his church in the great heavens above. All right. Fourth verse. Listen, John to the churches. Now, this is John speaking. First was God introducing the revelation of Jesus Christ. Second John, to the churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is, and which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before God. Oh, we just had a blackboard here now to get the drawing a little. See? The seven spirits which are before God. Now, to save a little time, and believing and knowing that I wouldn't misquote anything for nothing in the world, and if you get a little doubt about it, jot it down and then ask me and I'll give you the scripture for it. And now as we have to hurry to get into this, the press for time. Now, the seven spirits that are before God, these seven spirits was represented as the seven spirits that would be sent forth for the seven church ages. Seven spirits before God. We can pick up in the Old Testament and pick it out there if we just had time. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, and to him that loved us and washed us. I just look at John get all wound up there. When he just goes to speaking. He said, to him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. And has made us kings and priests unto God his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Has made us priests and kings unto God. Us is plural. Not made me priest and king, but made us, the church. Now he's addressing these seven churches, or seven church ages. Now, he said, dominion and glory and be to him forever and ever. Has made us priests. Did you ever know what a priest is, what his office is? A priest is to make sacrifice, to make intercession. And over in Hebrews, it said that we, the church, is a royal priesthood. A royal priesthood. A holy nation. A peculiar people. See? A holy nation, peculiar people, royal priesthood, offering. Here it is now, offering spiritual sacrifice.
Amen.
Every man and woman that comes to God enters into the veil in the Old Testament. There was only a veil that hung between the holy place and the holiest of holies. Only Aaron alone was to go in there once a year. But every man that became a priest could have a bite or taste of the original manna that Moses and Aaron picked up the first day the manna began to fall from heaven. When they crossed the river of Jordan, the enemies was killed behind them, and the next day they went out and all over the ground laid little wafers. God rained it down out of heaven. They called it manna. Tasted like honey. And people were just supposed to pick up enough to last them for that one day. If they kept it over, it contaminated. And God told Moses and Aaron to go out and pick up several omerfuls of it, great baskets, and take it into the ark, the holy place. And there that every time, after that generation, that every generation following that one, as long as that Levitical priesthood would last, I suppose, that every man that was eligible to become a priest, when he was ordained a priest, he had a perfect right to receive a mouthful of the original manna.
Amen.
Think of it. What a privilege that the man thought they would have when a man noted he was coming into the priesthood. He was going to get a mouthful of supernatural.
Amen.
Taste. Supernatural stirred up. Supernatural food that came from God out of heaven that had been kept supernaturally.
Amen.
The whole ministry is the supernatural. Amen. How can people ever say that they're Christians and deny the supernatural? I don't know how they do it myself. Look, but a supernatural. He got a swallow of the supernatural as soon as he become a priest. What a beautiful type of now. That every person, them days they had to be born in a certain lineage, a Levite, before they become a priest. But now it's whosoever will let him come.
Amen.
See?
And as soon as they come, oh, they must, a birth is considered in it also. You must be born again.
Amen.
And every man or woman that's born again of the Spirit of God has a right.
Amen.
For the this day, the manna. This manna is the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
When Peter, after they'd come out of the great confusion and the cowardliness that got away from them, and the Lord was blessing them, and the Holy Spirit fell at the day of Pentecost, they went out into the streets and began screaming and acting like crazy people, for insomuch that the people all thought they were drunk. Say, I wonder what we're going to do about that. Even the religious world then thought those people were drunk. And listen, my Catholic friend, the Blessed Virgin Mary was with them. And if she couldn't get to heaven until she went up there and got a taste of something that made her act like a drunk woman, how are you going to get there anything less than that? But she received something, 120 with the women, Mary Magdalene and those, and went out into the streets acting like drunk people.
Amen.
Staggering till the real, if you'll pardon the expression, the sophisticated church of that day said, look at them. That shows what they are. They're all full of new wine.
Amen.
That's what it was.
Amen.
Now, listen, Peter said, then they begin to say, said, you men of Jerusalem, you that dwell in Judea, let this be known unto you and hearken to my words. These are not drunk. I'm talking about the Ephesian church here now. See? All right, the first church age. He said, these are not drunk as you suppose. This is the third hour of the day. The saloons are not even open. This is the third hour of the day. He said, but this is that which is spoken of by the prophet Joel. It's written in your own Bible. In your own Bible, this is written, that this thing will take place. Well, I said, you ought to have known this, you teacher. Well, could it be just as the church was brought in under that demonstration, and the same demonstration promised for the last days? Can't you point back and say, this is what was spoken of?
Amen.
There you are. And the outside world doesn't know nothing about it. It's foolishness to them. Now, he said, looky here. And they said, now, when they heard this, he told them how that they had crucified Jesus. And every time you can get forgiveness for crucifying Jesus, you can get forgiveness for taking his name in vain. But who speaks against the Holy Ghost will never be forgiven in it. And this world or the world to come, we're in the last age. So be careful. Walk humbly, have a contrite, broken spirit, a humble heart, willing to let the Holy Spirit lead you.
Amen.
Amen. Alright. Oh, my. Here we are. They're all up there, just the people acting like they was cowards a few hours before, closed up in an upper room. But when the Holy Spirit come up on them and fill their hearts out into the streets, I don't imagine they were not doing things that was wrong. They were out there rejoicing and praising God in such a way that there was a manifestation. They were just not out there fussing with one another now, whether they were Methodists or Baptists, whether they were Pharisees or Sadducees. They were out there rejoicing because that they had got a taste of heaven in their soul. God had given them the spiritual manna. Now, as God poured out the manna there in the natural, and it lasted as long as they were in the journey. A beautiful time. In the day they entered the promised land, the manna ceased. And on the day of Pentecost, the same thing. Look at Pentecost to Moses. They looked back and they seen the enemy was dead. Miriam grabbed a tambourine, began to beat it and scream and dance and run down the bank. The women followed her doing the same thing. And Moses threw up his hands and sang in the Spirit.
Amen.
At Pentecost, the women come out staggering and jumping and dancing and carrying on. Peter stood up in the midst of them and said, "You men of Judea, and you that dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you to hearken to my words, for these are not drunk as you suppose, seeing it's the third hour of the day. This is that which is spoken of by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass the last day, saith God, I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, upon my handmaids and maidservants I'll pour out of my spirit. And they shall prophesy, and I'll show wonders in the heavens above and in the earth below, pillars of fire and vapor and smoke. And it shall come to pass before the great and terrible day of the Lord shall come, and whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved."
Amen.
On and on he went preaching. And when they heard this, they listened and said, "Look at that fellow. Where did he get this education?" Some of them said, "He can't even write his own name." The Bible said he was an ignorant and unlearned man. What school is he from? None. Well, how does this ever come about? How did this ever happen?
Amen.
They took heed and said, "Well, say, that man's really quoting Scripture, and we never heard it like that before."
Amen.
See? He said, "Repent, every one of you, and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
For the promise is unto you, your children, to them as far off, and as many as the Lord our God shall call."
Amen.
In other words, this man of blessing that's fallen here like it did the manna back there is going to be for this generation, the next generation, to Jeffersonville, Indiana, and to the utmost parts of the world.
Amen.
And the
Amen.
Same Holy Spirit that fell then falls now.
Amen.
Same result.
Amen.
Same thing. Same people.
Hallelujah.
See what I mean?
Amen.
Just perfect. Notice, "I will give unto him, he that overcomes, I'll give him the bread of life."
Amen.
He said that to one of the churches. "And he'll not thirst no more, neither shall he hunger no more." He'll never thirst no more. If a man ever once, here it is, get the jacket tightened up tight.
Amen.
If a man or a woman ever truly once receives the Holy Spirit,
Amen.
You'll never be able to move him no more.
Hallelujah.
He knows where he's at.
Amen.
You may come with isms and everything. He'll walk right straight through.
Amen.
He'll never thirst no more. He knows just exactly who his maker is.
Amen.
Never be confused. Don't bother him.
Amen.
He moves right on.
Amen.
"I will give to him all the bread of life, and he'll never hunger no more, and neither will he thirst anymore.
Amen.
And the tree Amen. Which is in the midst of the paradise of God, and he'll eat from."
Amen.
The tree, which the tree was Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And Christ Jesus being dead and come back in the form of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So he's here, and the manna that's eaten in the church. Notice, behold, the sixth verse. "And he has made us priests and kings unto God, spiritual priesthood, royal nation." Spiritual offering, what is it now? Spiritual sacrifices.
Amen.
That is, quote the Scripture, that is the fruit of our lips giving praise to his name.
Amen.
What kind of a what? A spiritual sacrifice.
Right.
Now we might as well get started right here. Notice a good place to start from. When a little confusion comes in the church, you don't run over to one side and pout now.
Amen.
You are. You sure ain't a priest.
See?
You pray through. Spiritual sacrifice.
Amen.
The fruits of our lips giving praise to his name.
Amen.
See what I mean? Well, you say, "I just don't feel like going to church." But you're a priest.
Amen.
It's your duty. Amen. You've got to be there. Well, "I just don't feel like taking a part in the service." You're a priest.
Amen.
Making a sacrifice.
Amen.
A spiritual sacrifice.
Amen.
Not giving somebody some hand-me-downs, as they call it today. That's all good. I have nothing against it. Not going to get somebody to come to church. That's all good. I have nothing against it. But it's you.
Amen.
You making the spiritual sacrifice. The fruits of your lips giving praise to his name. When you see the time coming and everybody blaspheming and saying these things and doing things wrong, what do? Walk away? You're supposed to stand there with a spiritual sacrifice. Then the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses from all sin. makes me a new creature in Christ Jesus. You're crazy, fella. According to what you say, it's all right. But to me, it's the power of God unto salvation.
Amen.
I believe it. Now, say you believe in divine healing.
I don't really better ask our pastor.
What do you think about it? You're the priest now. You're the guy to say, yes, sir, I believe it, because God's word says it so. You believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Yes, sir. How do you know I've received it? A spiritual blessing. The Holy Spirit that fell on the apostles, the same Holy Spirit falls now.
Amen.
You say just for the apostles. We'll settle that in a little while. See what's going on.
All right. A spiritual priesthood offering spiritual sacrifices.
Now the eighth verse of the seventh. Behold, he cometh with clouds. Now, let me stop here just a moment. Cloud doesn't mean that he's coming on a big thunderhead. His mama, bless her heart, she's sitting here somewhere. I was a little boy, she used to sit and tell me, said, he's coming on a great big cloud, going to raise someday, and God's going to come. And now, the cloud that he's coming in, if we just had the time to get all this back and get the real background of the whole thing, now, the cloud he's coming in is not a cloud like a thunderhead, but it's a cloud of glory. He's coming in, see? Now, when Jesus was overshadowed by God on Mount Transfiguration, clouds overshadowed him and his raiment, see? And when Elijah was come down, a cloud come down and received him up. Not a pillar of fire, not a thunderhead, but a cloud of glory. His great, glorious presence shall strike the earth. He cometh, and clouds. Oh, I love that. Clouds. There'll be wave after wave of his glory will come across the earth, and the resurrection of the saints shall come. Well, that blessed Holy Spirit that lived in their hearts, and they died with their corpse laying there, and the tear stains over their cheeks, and things like that. They're placed out here in the graveyard. A great wave of that same Spirit now. Wave after wave. He that was last will be first, and he that was first will be last. How can it be that way? That's the order of the resurrection. I won't know nobody in the generation before me or the generation after me. I know those in the generation of this, and every generation will come successfully right as it went down. They which were last will be first. Sure, it has to be. See, I'll know my people, the next one, my dad will know his people, his grandfather, his people, on down like that, wave after wave after wave after wave, and the saints are rising from everywhere. Won't that be wonderful? Amen. That makes the old people feel young again. Yes. Now, notice closely. All right, comes in a cloud, and every eye shall see him. No matter how far back they died, they'll still see him. And they also which pierced him, and all the kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him, even so, amen. John just had to holler, amen. If so be it, let it be that way. I am Alpha and Omega. Now, Alpha is the A in the Greek alphabet. Omega is the Z in the Greek alphabet. In other words, if it was translated today, I am A to Z. Now, who else is it? I am the first, I am the last. I am from A to Z. Wish we had time to get in on the deity of Christ right now, which would be very appropriate at this time. The deity. So days when so many people are trying to make him just a teacher, just a philosopher, are merely a prophet. He was God. He was either God or the biggest deceiver the world's ever had. If he was a prophet, his blood was a man. If he was a teacher, an educator, his blood was a man. He was God and his blood was divine. Almighty God overshadowed the Virgin Mary and created the blood cell in her womb that brought forth the Son Christ Jesus, and God condescended and lived in that body. God Emmanuel made flesh among us. Take away the sins. When God made his first man, he made him in his own image, which was a spirit man. Genesis 1:26. All right.
Then there was no man to till the soil. After done made man, male and female. We'll get into that at 117 stars, but he made both male and female back there in the beginning. That's right. In his own image, in God's spirit. And then Genesis 2, there was no man to till the soil, so God put him in the flesh, made man not in his image, but out of the dust of the earth. That's right. Give him a hand like a monkey and a foot like a bear, whatever, I don't know. But he gave him five senses to contact his earthly home. And then that man sinned, and God came down and was made man. To take away the sin of man.
Amen.
Amen. Redeeming. I am Alpha and Omega. I look at him over here in Revelation, the fourth chapter, when John turned to see this voice again, what was speaking to him. He was sitting upon a throne, and a rainbow was over his head. And the rainbow has got seven perfect colors. And these seven perfect colors represented the seven church ages. Now try it again. And what was it? Here it is.
Brother, this is fresh.
Look. Seven perfect colors, seven, and a rainbow represents the covenant.
Amen.
God gave Noah the rainbow first as a covenant.
Amen.
And those elements are still in the earth as God promised before him. When it rains, he sees the bow. He said, I'll never destroy it with water no more. And then he looked upon Jesus as seven rainbow colors above him. He was in this which was God's covenant. And he was standing amidst seven golden candlesticks, and he was to look upon as jasper and sardis stone. Jasper was Reuben, and sardis stone was Benjamin. That was the first and the last of the patriarchs. That Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, and the seven rainbow colors, seven church ages, the covenant with him in the seven golden candlesticks of the seven stars. Oh, what a picture. If we get to it after a while, maybe the Lord willing. All right, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and ending. Saith the Lord, which is, which was, and which is to come, the Almighty.
Amen.
Who is he?
Amen.
What's this a revelation of? Jesus Christ. And here he's not a prophet. Here he is, the Almighty God, manifested, the Alpha, Omega. I'm from A to Z. I'm he that was, which is, and shall come. I am the Almighty. Pretty clear, isn't it? No chance of controversy there. Lord, which was, which is, and shall come, the Almighty. Now John speaks. Listen. I, John, who also am your brother in compassion and tribulation and in the kingdom, the patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle called Patmos for the word of God. Say, could you imagine a man being put in a place like that for the word of God?
Amen.
Yes, for the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. He was exiled out there for preaching the word to a religious people.
Amen.
That's what the word says, isn't it? He was out there for preaching, exiled, excommunicated from the church, from society, from all the world. Amen. But he wasn't excommunicated from the one who loved him and washed him in his own blood. He was with his presence in the isle called Patmos for the word of God's sake. I wonder how many preachers today would go. Get down to even go do a little something, get upset. We get so disturbed about it. You hear this man had been boiled in grease for 24 hours and thrown out on the Isle of Patmos, and the Lord is still with him.
Amen.
I just like that old song we used to sing, if Jesus goes with me, I'll go anywhere.
Amen.
We sing it, but I wonder if we really mean it. To my honest opinion, it won't be too long or you're going to be given a chance to prove it. So you better be really sure. Check up, take inventory, see if everything's just right. Now, just got a... Getting started here now, John answers, and he said he was in the Isle of Patmos for the word of God to testimony. I was in the Spirit. I like that.
I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Speaking of another day now to my Advent friends, which we're sure to get into it after a while. All right? In the Spirit on the Lord's day. Got in the Spirit. And I heard behind me a great voice of a trumpet. Let's not leave these symbols now. We're basing up now so we know what we're talking about when we get over here. See what we're going to speak about. Who is it? What is this fellow? What's the revelation of Jesus Christ? Who is he anyhow? How did he come? What does it mean to me? See if it means anything to you. See what it takes place or to me. Notice, I was in the Spirit. No matter how saintly you are, how godly you are, how much of a minister or lay member, whatever you are, you'll never be able to get anywhere with God till you get in the Spirit.
Amen.
I don't mean getting emotion. I mean getting the Spirit. Yeah, see? You get the emotion, do anything. But when you get in the Spirit, you see things.
Amen.
That's right. I can imagine old Elijah, the old prophet, down there that day when Ahab's son made an alliance with some unbelievers, and Jehoshaphat had joined in with them, and he went out in the desert for 7 days and didn't fetch any compass for just 7 days, and that take care of him for 7 days. Didn't consult the Lord, just went on out anyhow. Isn't that just like people? Oh, I'll tell you, if that's a better job, I'll just quit this church and go over to that one. I better consult the Lord about that. Find out what it is. Went out there and found out they got in trouble. The water supply got cut off. That's what's the matter with the churches today. Going around doing a lot of things you don't consult the Lord about, your supply is getting cut off. You wonder why you're not getting the blessings you used to get, the power of God working among you. Maybe the supply line's been cut.
Amen.
You know, when you get out water, I get into the desert sometime out there in Arizona, and I notice that every little old bush on that desert is harmful. It'll stick you. Every time you get against it, it'll stick you. Because it doesn't have enough water to take care of it, stickers come out. Far as it's been. You come back up here or up in Oregon or somewhere where it rains all the time, and every one of them same kind of bushes has got a sticker on them. See, the water keeps them soft. And that's what's the matter with the church. When you get all dried up and shackled up and everything, you get so cold and formal and indifferent, you don't get any spiritual blessing, then your heart gets all filled up and full of indignation and wrath, and everybody, I'll get even with him, I'll get even with her, I quit the church. Just a bunch of stickers living in the desert.
Amen.
Right. What you need, some good old-fashioned Holy Spirit water rain down upon you. Soften up that old card. Amen. I'm not trying to clown. I'm trying to get this to you.
Amen.
Brother, you're going to find out if you take the mark of the beast where you're going to be standing.
Amen.
And you're absolutely helpless and hopeless when you do it.
Amen.
There's no remission for it. You can never get out of it. Right? You can do it by the wink of your eye, nearly. See? So be careful. Now, here it is. Well, give unto him. Notice the desert, I said, the waters, how that the waters kept them soft. That's what we do today. Get in the Spirit. John said, I was in the Spirit. When Elijah out on the desert, they come down to Jehoshaphat and said, let's go down and consult the prophet. They went out in front of the prophet. Well, now he got up his righteous indignation. He looked over to that fellow. And he said, why don't you go to your mother's God? Why don't you go back to your own old cold formal church? What'd you come to me for when you got in trouble? That wasn't a very good thing to say. But that's just so much words that meant that. Why'd you come down to me? Why don't you go to your mother's God? You all had those big fine churches and all those fine fed priests and so forth back there. Go on back and ask them about it. Why'd you come down here to me? He kind of got all stuffed up sure enough, didn't he? He said, it wasn't I respected the presence of that godly man, Jehoshaphat, I wouldn't even look at you. Oh, my. What a condition that prophet got into. Now he's all in that kind of fix and said, well, bring me a minstrel. Some people don't believe in music in the church. But he said, bring me a minstrel. And when the minstrel began to play some good old hymn, hear my blasphemy, whatever you want to call it, I don't know. When the minstrel began to pray, the Spirit of God got on the prophet. And when the Spirit got on him, he got in a vision. He began to see things. You have to get the Spirit of God. And you say, I can't understand how people can say amen. Get the Spirit one.
Amen.
I can't see how they stand at the baseball game and beat one another, bat and holler and hoot and pull their hats down and carry on. Seems like crazy to me. Well, you say you're not a very good baseball fiend. I'm just about as much. How about you as a Christian? All right. That's right. You've got to get into the Spirit of it. That's the way it is when you used to go to dances. I don't need you to go now. Surely not.
But if you used to go, they had to play up the hoop-up music and beat the bands and beat the drums and do every kind of a thing there was about it, and the women run out there half-naked and everything else and dance on the floor and things, get to the Spirit to dance. Well, that's right. You get in the Spirit of it. It's the Spirit of the devil.
Glad you said amen, because it's the truth. I'll prove it by the Bible. Right? All right.
Say, well, I don't believe it, brother. Well,
it ain't what you say or what I think. It's what God's Word says. That's what settles it. That's the final word.
Yes, sir. He said, if you love the world, things of the world, love of God's not even in you.
That's right. And you remember when that little old woman taught her daughter to tap dance and things like that and went down there and danced before the king and required the head of John the Baptist? 70 of her children died as prostitutes on Galilee.
See what it does like that.
Moses' mother stayed home and kept him and taught him the word of the Lord. You see what happened to him. And his, through him come out Abraham and so forth and on down.
Amen.
All right, just depends on what you want to do. You're a free moral agent. You act on whatever you desire to act upon. Right? God has put before man like the Garden of Eden, the tree of life and the tree of death. You make your choice.
Amen.
See? Whatever your soul is charmed for, that's what you'll eat. Notice. Now, and they were, I want to read this again now. He was in the Spirit. The Spirit come up on him. He began to see things. Now watch. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard. I got in the Spirit on the Lord's day and I heard behind me a great voice of a trumpet. Trumpet. Trumpet is an announcement. Gabriel, at the coming of the Lord, shall sound the trump of God.
Yes.
This is God's trumpet blowing.
Yes.
In other words, he's fixing to announce the eternal destination of the world. A trumpet. What is it? Get ready. I'm going to give you the revelation of Jesus Christ to give
Amen.
To the church. I'll speak to you what will be the destination of the world for those who receive and those who reject. A trumpet of God. Attention. Every man with a trumpet blows, he grabs his sword and stands to a place. Attention. The trumpet. Paul said, the trumpet gives the uncertain sound. Who shall prepare for war? That's the way it is today. Oh, brothers! Now look around and see all these cold, formal, different churches and things like that having a form of godliness and denying the power of that. How can a man prepare himself? Giving an uncertain sound. Say, well, I'll join the churches. I'll go and try the Methodist or the Baptist or the Lutheran or the Pentecostals. I'll do something. I'll make some kind of move. Oh, that's not it.
Amen.
Except the man be born again. I don't care if he's Methodist, Baptist, Pentecostal, or whatever he is. You've got to be born again.
Amen.
You'll not enter the kingdom. Amen. Look. Voice of a trumpet saying to me, I'm Alpha and Omega. The first thing he introduces here, that I am the first and the last. The first thing when the trumpet of God sounded out, he turned and he said, I'm Alpha and Omega. I'm from A to Z.
Amen.
I'm all of it now. Stand and listen to me a while. All right. The first and the last. What thou seest, write in a book. That's this book we're reading. And send it unto the, where? Addressed specifically, whereabouts? Back to the age, no, to the church. To the church. Notice, what thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, which was a type of the church. Now we'll get into that in a few minutes. Showing how the Old Testament typed up in seven ages. Seven churches set here in ages. which the Bible plainly teaches, which was a shadow or type of the seven church ages that was coming. And by God's help, and with the Bible, can prove that every church age landed just exactly where it said it would, just exactly where the Bible said it would, and we're at the end of the last church age. And go back in the Old Testament, pick up Daniel's dream, and show him the vision of the Gentile kingdom, how that he saw Amy standing with a head of gold, breast of silver, and thighs of brass, and feet and legs of iron and clay, and show how every one of those kingdoms have succeeded one another just exactly the way the Bible says. And look, the head of gold, Babylon, Medes and Persia, Greece, and the Roman Empire. And the Roman Empire broke up into 10 kingdoms, Eastern and Western Rome, and so forth. And in there, there was iron and clay, and they wouldn't mix together. Protestant and Catholicism under the same Gentile domination. And he said, even to try to break one another's power, they would intermarry with one another. Just exactly what they're doing today. Exactly. And that kingdom in the days of those kings, the God of heaven cut a stone out of the mountain without hands, that smote this image in the feet and broke all the Gentile kingdoms down, and the kingdom of Christ ruled and reigned and rose and covered the earth in the sea and the sky.
Amen.
Gentile kingdoms painted away like trash, like a husk on a threshing floor in the summertime. What a picture that we're living in. That's true. And today you see Catholic and Protestant marrying among one another, trying to break the powers down. We raise your children, have to promise them to raise them this way or that way. We'll get into it after a bit, in a few nights. Notice how it is, and how the other, the strong of the iron, dominated over the other. Broke it to pieces and shattered it away. But the Lamb came and stood, and the holy people. And that day, how that Roman power went through every nation. There's not another power in the world. And only one way it can go through is through Catholicism, the Catholic Church, into all the world. Breaking out in there. It's a marvelous, great picture here. Now, to you Protestants, just keep your shoes on, because, brother, you're right with it. Now, I can prove it to God's Word. You're right into it, just as big as the rest of them. Now, watch. Now, the first and the last. What you see, write in a book. Now I said unto him, write this in a book and send it to the churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus and to Sardis and Pergamus and so forth and Philadelphia and Laodicea. Now, we'll stop there just a moment or two, just see how much time I got, because I want to get to this last keynote here on Ephesus and pull it over to Laodicea and see if we're not patterned up in the same church. See if we're not living in this day. Oh, Church of the Living God, rise and shine. Look, you don't realize. I wish I had some kind of a shock that I could give you some way. I wish the Holy Spirit would come in His great power and move you to a place that you grab this Bible and say, let me look into this. When you see nations are breaking, Israel awakening, the signs that the Bible foretold, Gentile days numbered, with horrors encumbered, return, O dispersed, to your own. That's right. The day of redemption is near. Man's hearts are failing for fear. Be filled with God's Spirit, your lamp trimmed and clear. Look up! Your redemption is near. That's right. Oh, what a day! Write and send it to the churches. Now, just as Israel come in its beauty, back in the beginning under Abraham, come on down to the patriarch. And in the day of Ahab, it went into the dark ages, the darkest age that the church seen. Went out of there, and in that time, how that Ahab married Jezebel, brought idolatry into the Orthodox Church, the same thing that Protestantism married Romanism in the 1500 years of dark ages in the Persian Church, and come out with idolatry under the form of Christianity. Going on out into lukewarm age is coming on before, and we're in it right now. We're in the lukewarm age.
You don't believe it? Now I'm going to sit down on the you people out in the other churches. You're no lukewarm age and you're advances across the earth, around the earth, preaching things like that. You're getting nowhere. You're hollering, you Baptists are hollering a million more in 44. What have you got when you got them? Just got a bunch of sinners come in with their names on the book. That's right, said it belongs to Baptist Church. Not only that, but the other Methodists, Camelites, and the whole group. Justice Farmer and the different. Billy Graham had that 30,000 converts, he said, in 6 weeks. And 6 weeks later, he couldn't find 30. Why? Why? They never got nothing to start with. Just a bunch of sinners went in and put their name on the book, on the spell of the revival. He said the kingdom of heaven is like one fish net to see when he brought forth. He had everything. He had turtles, he had crawfish, he had terrapins, he had spiders, he had water bugs, he had serpents. Right. But in there he had some fish also. And when a man preaches a revival on the power and demonstration of the Holy Spirit, the net is drawn around the people. That's right.
Amen.
But if he's a bug to begin with, he's
Amen.
A bug at the end of the revival.
Yeah.
If he's a water spider, the first thing you know, he'll go look around and say, I don't believe in this little stuff anyhow. Pop off back to the water.
Amen.
If he's a snake, you'll say, I told you about it, and away he'll go. He was a snake to begin with. His nature was. And he'll never be nothing else until that nature's changed. A man can't join church or get all emotional worked up or anything else and become a Christian. It's got to be a solid birth of the Spirit. Sincerity, dying out, crying out, laying there until he's dead twice. Remember, life can only come out of death. A grain of corn, if it abides, it abide alone, it'll never mean no more than that one grain of corn. Except the corn of wheat fall in the earth, it abides alone. But when it falls there, it rots, contaminates, and out of that midst of corruption comes the germ of life that gives it life and produces more. Except the church will be born again, die out till its creeds and theologies and so forth, and be born anew of the Spirit of God. It will be an old, formal, ungodly, indifferent.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
That's right. That's old-fashioned sass-brass preaching, but it'll save you, brother. Right. It'll keep you when the storm's going hard. Get rooted and grounded. Get all the dirt scraped off for you, pour your concrete.
Amen.
Notice, that's right, and the anchor rod's down good and tight. Oh, brother, what a day that we're living in.
Hallelujah.
Formal, indifferent, church age. Yes, sir, to the seven churches that send this message. Now in that church age, they begin to come in. They wedded into idolatry. They do the same thing now. They come in doing the same thing. And out of that come in formal Christianity. Begin to fading away until we're getting down to the last church age. Now, the modern church, which we call the denomination, we holiness people, you know. We call them the moderns. And they go out there and they start their revival too. You say they're not getting anywhere, but now wait just a minute. What do we got? Got nothing. No more than they got. That's exactly right. As long as we fuss and stew and carry on among one another, we still walk as man. Until a man can get out the altar and get right with God, he can overlook little things and move on like a Christian ought to. Pot can't call kettle black.
Amen.
Right. Don't harm them.
Amen.
Let's clean our own steps first.
Amen.
Excuse the strangers. I'm giving the church a little gospel spanking now. No, that's right.
Amen.
Exactly what you need. Oh, you say, we got it. Get up there and beat a piano as hard as you can go and a bunch of drums and run up and down the floor and go out and fuss at your neighbor. Have you got anything?
No,
sir. The only thing we got is the lukewarm. As long as the music's running, we're running. When the music stops, we stop. Brother, don't call the other fellow something. Let's look around your own door first.
Amen.
I tell you, when you're old-fashioned revival like you used to have down the country when they lay on their face all night long, not to carry on, but when real godly sorry, not go there to all their state, but go out and make it right with the neighbors that made it wrong with and get straightened up.
Scorching the brother, it'll help you.
That's right. You've got to know that, my friend. Yes, sir, lukewarm.
That's a horrible condition for the church to be in. You don't watch the Grand Tabernacle about in that same sway. Listen, you know these things have been taught year after year after year after year on this platform, warning you of these things coming. When the Bible said there'd be a time to go from the east and the west and north and south trying to find the true word of God and fail to find it, you better get anchored, for you know where you're standing. But when a man is once born again, not emotionally worked up, not from enthusiasm, not but from his name on a church book, not to join the biggest church in the city, but when he's actually cried to and begged with tears in his eyes until God has forgiven his sins, cleansed his soul of the life of sin, and filled him with the Holy Spirit with such love and godly, till he takes some old tar tools back, he's stolen the neighbors, and goes and makes up these things and lives godly before men. We'll never have a revival in this country till we have that. Judgment begins at the house of God, by the Word of God. Amen. Not a textbook, but the Bible. Not what some church teaches their theology, but what God says. Then you'll have a revival where great powers and wonders and signs and miracles and everything else will take place. We're lukewarm. Because we're lukewarm in this age, God said, I'll spew you from my mouth. This church age will be rejected. There'll be a remnant out of it that'll be saved. So better mark yourself right good to find out if you're in that remnant now. We'll get into it in a minute, if God willing. Just notice now. And I turned to see the voice that spake unto me. And being turned, look, I saw seven golden candlesticks, or lampstands, the Greek says. Now, that's the first translation, because they didn't have the candles enough. They had the little lampstands. Now, the seven golden candlesticks, we call them. Now, in the holy place where the shewbread, and many of you clergymen understand, and that you people here at the tabernacle being taught with a good teacher here, you know these things. The seven golden candlesticks, they were had little lamps on top of them that burnt oil. Over in Zechariah, where he saw the vision, I believe it was, and he saw the wild olive tree and the tame olive tree, the Jew and the Gentile, way before the dispensation of the Gentile, and it had a golden censer, and both of these golden censers run into this one candlestick here that furnished oil for all the lamps. And he couldn't understand how these things look. The wild olive tree and the tame olive tree. And the tame olive tree, of course, is broke off the wild olive tree, drafted into it. And that oil to the lamp, oil represents the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Always. We're getting that on the mark of the people Friday night. Notice, but this oil represents Holy Spirit. That's why we anoint the sick with oil, is because it represents the Holy Spirit. The Bible said in Revelation, the 6th chapter, when the plague went through, he said, a measure of wheat for a penny and 2 measures of barley for a penny, but don't hurt my wine and my oil. Which we're going to take Revelations on through for a few weeks and get into that, who that wine and oil is. See that you hurt not my wine and my oil. Won't you come near it? Amen. Now, notice, these golden candlesticks, this oil poured into these candlesticks. Now, the oil was what was put in the lamp to burn. Now, Aaron, it was his duty to light these lamps. And these lamps had to be lit. Hold it on now. Look. Keep reverent and listen. These lamps had to be lit by the fire that God had lit.
Amen.
Aaron's sons went in with some strange fire, and God slew them in the door. That's right. Strange fire. The fire that God started. And what? Now the candlesticks run in an arch. Here was one candlestick, two, three, four. Well, five, six, seven. Like this. Now those golden candlesticks here, as he says in a few minutes, let's read a little farther, maybe we'll get it. And listen to what he said now. Alright, and his head, I believe I've got ahead of the 12th verse there. Seven golden candlesticks, 13th verse. And in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and a girdle about the paps of the golden girdle. His head was his hair was as white as wool, white as snow, and his eyes were flames of fire. Now let's stop there just a minute, because we can't leave that picture there just like that. Look at these candlesticks down here now. Those candlesticks, as we'll find a little later, represents the seven church ages. They represent Ephesus, Pergamus, all down to Philadelphia, and all over to Laodicea, seven church ages. And each one of these little candlesticks had a little cruse of oil sitting there. And this oil burnt on this candle. Now, when one candle was lit by the fire of God, they take in that candle and lift the other one, then set it down and lift the other one, and one lit off the other, and off the other, and off the other, to the last candle. Notice, same oil. Now, these seven church ages begin with Ephesus, Tyre, Pergamus, and all through, and the Holy Spirit, which is the oil of God, fell on the church at the beginning in Ephesus, the Ephesian church, which was the church of grace. You Baptists sort of holler amen there. And then on the church of grace, which in Ephesus, in the Ephesian letter, it sets us out who he was before the foundation of the world. It fell there and they received the Holy Spirit. But wait a minute, my Baptist brother. How did they receive it? How did they get it? By joining the church? Never. They got it by the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You say, yes, Brother Brown, that's right. What happened to you when it fell on you?
Amen.
Notice, the same fire that burnt the oil there in Ephesus burned it in Tyre. The same fire burnt there, burnt in Pergamus. Burn on down through to the Laodicean church age. The same Holy Spirit lit by the same God, by the same fire, and the fire that fell on Pentecost has lit the candle of the church to ever age, right on down. But the trouble of this, we Baptists, we Methodists, we're way back up here trying to take some historical thing, and here goes the church down here.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
That's where we're left behind. Every church, when it started, there wasn't. Look at Luther in the First Reformation. What a revival. Luther. Look, I've got his textbook at home. How did that man shook under the power of God? How he believed in divine healing, accepted it himself, believed in the power of God, even so much till he spoke in tongues. Martin Luther. That's exactly right. Martin Luther spoke with tongues. And then the next age come down, John Wesley. John Wesley done the same thing. When he was preaching, he said, what are these words that I utter unknown to myself? That's right. Speaking with tongues, believed in divine healing. And when he come to America, the churches here treat him like they do the holy rollers today. They put him out in churches and they preach the gospel out there and fell under the power of God until they laid on the floor all night at a time. And John Wesley's own textbook that I got at home now, where he was riding a horse one day to pray for a woman. It was sick, and the horse fell and broke its leg, and he got off the horse and took a cruse of oil and anointed the horse with oil and got on it and rode away.
Amen.
Same fire burning there.
Amen.
But you've got it down to a ritualistic form of something, and the Holy Ghost is moving on.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
And in the Methodist Church, they got something wrong with them. Their book says they got the jerk. And they were starting to walk and they jerk and jump and act like that.
Amen.
In their tent meetings and things. The Methodists.
Amen.
Wow, brother, if John Wesley could rise on the scene, he'd be so ashamed of you, he'd deny you.
Amen.
Unless he give you a good gospel whipping with the gospel that he preached.
Amen.
I stood out all over the shrine where they turned them hounds loose that day when he was preaching the new birth and so forth and that. And the High Church of England turned them dogs loose for him. And he said, the sun will not fall on your head three times. He called me to pray for him. And he did and died. That's right. Sure. That's what we need today. We need that kind of Methodist. We need another Baptist like John Smith, who stayed in the room and agonized with God and prayed all night in such a way till his eyes were swollen so bad at morning his wife would lead him to the table to eat.
Amen.
Oh, what do we do today? Stand out on the corner with a cigarette in their mouth, a deacon in the church, and go down and act the picture shows and watch televisions all night and stay away from church, smoke, drink, gamble, run the horse races, and call ourselves Baptists. Oh, yeah! What we need today is another old-fashioned, God I ain't trying to get you to get excited. I know you're not excited, but brother, that's the truth. I'm just a point to you. The truth is what we need. All right. Now, that's the Bible. That's what the Spirit says, see? The candlestick. All right. Now, the 13th verse. And in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, one like the Son of Man. What one like him? Who was this? His bride. One like him. Watch how it was. Clothed with a garment down to the foot. The holiness of Jesus Christ covered her. Has washed us from our sins with his own blood. Or girded about the path, not a man, a woman, with a golden girdle, the gospel that helps the power and glory of God over the body of Christ. Oh, what a beautiful picture we got here under consideration. Look at here. Down to the foot, and a girdle about the path with a golden girdle. His head, his hair was white as wool, white as snow. Righteousness, holiness, white speaks of. And his eyes like flames of fire. Looks right to it. Don't try to hide from him. He knows who you are, where you are, and what you've done. Yes, sir. He sees everything. Oh, God, we got this few minutes. Let's get to this other church age if we can. Notice, and his feet were like fine brass. Brass always is judgment. You know the brazen altar and the brass serpent and so forth? Brass speaks of judgment. His feet, then the church of Jesus Christ is set upon divine judgment. Christ dying in our stead, the just one, paying our judgment up there before God and died there as a sinner on the cross, and his soul ascended into hell, and God not suffering his Holy One to see corruption, raised him up on the third day for our justification. Who sits at his right hand now, a high priest, can be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, which shall return in like manner as he went into heaven to receive a glorious church that's made herself ready, blood washed and second born. What a vision. Amen. All right. Like fine bread. Or now watch. And his feet was like fine bread, as if it had been burned in a furnace. That's all the dross taken out. And his voice, the voice of many waters. Watch this, the church speaking to him now. Waters, Revelation 17:15 said waters means sickness and multitudes of people. Now his voice, or this being that was standing there looking like this, Christ in his church, as bride and Christ being one, like husband and wife is one, the church and Christ being molded together with one person, the same Holy Spirit, and the things that Christ did, the church does also. Do you see it? That beautiful church there, in holiness, in power, in majesty, with seeing visions, signs, wonders, everything just like he did, here it is on earth, giving all praise to God, saying, I can do nothing except the Father shows me, but he shows me. And here it is, and we come to see these things go taking place. Now, Christ molded into one, and the voice of many waters, many people, not just the one, it was the whole church, the seven churches molded together as one great ransom body of the Lord. The Methodist, the Baptist, the Presbyterian, all that's born again with the Holy Ghost. Speaking with the power of God. That's the body. That's the body. And he had in his right, everything in the Bible has a meaning to it. See? In his right hand, seven stars. He's a king. And out of his mouth was a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like unto the sun shining in his strength. Now, out of his mouth goes a sharp two-edged sword. Out of the mouth of this standing there, Christ in the church is one. In his hand, he held seven stars. You'll see in a few minutes, we'll get to it. Let the Bible just speak what it was. It was the seven ministers, one minister to each age of these seven church ages, coming out, hold them in his right hand. Amen. Amen. There he is. There were seven angels, seven messengers, one to each church. Get it? There he's standing there. And out of his mouth goes a sharp two-edged sword. What is a sharp two-edged sword? Hebrews, the 4th chapter, said the word of God is sharper, more powerful than a two-edged sword, even going to the mire of the bone and a discerner of the thoughts of the mind. Or, and when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead, and he laid his right hand on me, saying, fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth.
liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and death.
Amen.
That's Jesus.
Amen.
Now watch. Write these things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and these things which shall be hereafter. All right. And the mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand are hand, and the seven golden candlesticks, the seven stars are seven angels of the seven churches. Hold that. Seven angels are seven ministers of the seven churches. There's the church of the leader of Ephesus. Now, if God would permit, and we continue on with this and not take the mark of beast, I can show you every one of them right down to this last age, which it was. Show you the Philadelphian church, which was the Methodist, John Wesley. Show you the church hierarchy immediately after Fergus, which was Martin Luther. And go right on down the age and show each one of them. They come and brought the message, established the message in the earth, and right down to the last message today. That's right. Where God sent an angel from heaven, vindicated his servant, and set a message for us to everyone. This will not be a church. It will not be an organization in this last days, because God has laid the organization on the shelf, and all of you are aware of that. And wait till we get through tomorrow night on the mark of the beast and see where your church is at. See, in your organization. Now what? The churches. And the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. They are the churches, and the stars, which is holding each star. Now look, could we just stop a minute? I know I've got about 12 minutes to go here. I want to get to this chapter right here and read it through, if nothing else. I want to get this to you. A star was a minister, and a minister anointed with a spirit from above. Do you realize that you represent a star in heaven, and every star in heaven represents you?
Amen.
Did you know God told Abraham that his seed would be like the stars of the heaven? First they were the dust of the earth, and then in the resurrection they were the stars of heaven, innumerable. Did you realize that? Did you know Jesus was the bright and morning star, the greatest star of all the stars of heaven?
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Trying to think of it, my soul leaps for joy. There he is. There in his likeness, in his presence, we shall be seated someday. Hallelujah. One of the things of this earth is passed away. Listen, another scripture comes to me. Daniel said one, he said, close when he seen his angel come down with a rainbow over his head, put one foot on the land and one on the sea, and held up his hands and swore by him that lives from ever and ever. When those seven voices uttered the seven thunders uttered their voices, he said, seal it, not knowing until the last day. He said, but the time the ministry of God should be finished, when these will be revealed to the church, and swore by him that lives forever and ever, that time should be no more. Listen what he said there then. He said, go thy way, Daniel. Shut up the book. See? For thou shalt rest, and you shall stand in the last days in your lot. But many of those who turn many to righteous shall outshine the stars forever and forever.
Amen.
There you are. Stars, those seven ministers. Seven ministers through seven church ages, which consists of 2,000 years. From the first 2,000 years, the Antediluvian destruction, the second 2,000 years, the first coming of Christ, the third 2,000 years, the sixth is the last second coming of Christ, and the millennium, and the end, the seventh day rest unto the church. Oh, will you bear with me just a few minutes longer? Now, I don't want to wear you out, but I'll read right fast now. Unto the angel, now watch, he's addressing this directly now. We're going over to Fergus and get the last seventh, and I mean to the lady of sin, and then we'll close. Tomorrow night we'll pick up from here on the mark of the beast. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, the first. Now watch, when Jesus is standing with his hands out, here's a little thing I don't want to leave out to you. Here, watch him. He's standing in the midst, that's the middle, of the seven golden candlesticks. Now, if I was standing here and the candlesticks arched around, here on my one hand is where I got out, and here's another in the side of the cross part, was through the cross that brought the church. Here he is standing in a rainbow over his head as a covenant. I've made my covenant with this church through Abraham, through his seed, all is called. My brother the other night receiving Christ, he said, don't ever push me, Bill. He said, when God speaks to me, I said, you can't come until he calls you. No man can come to me except my Father calls. Somebody does something else, pulls you up, that's somebody else. But when God speaks, you'll come.
See? That's right. Stand there, no man can come except my Father draws him. There he is, standing there to look upon his jasper and sardis stone, the first and the last, Benjamin, Reuben, all the 12 patriarchs, and how the Bible, every bit just dovetails right straight together like that. Everything perfect. Notice, as he's standing there to look upon now, watch what takes place. He said he was Alpha and Omega. He was the beginning and the ending. He which was and which is and shall come had in his right hand now the seven stars. Now, here he started off with Ephesus. And he begins to light the candlestick. He lit it there. Then the next age, we find out the next church age, it begins to dim out. The next church age dims a little more. Until the fourth church age, the 1500 years of dark ages, and around 500, 1500 along in there, it began to get so dark until it was way up and it almost went out. And notice each one of those church ages said, "You have not denied my name. You have not denied my name. You have not denied my name." But when he comes out on the other side of the dark ages, he said, "Thou hast a name, that thou livest and are dead." Yeah. Should organize. Should tuck up another false name. Watch tomorrow night what the Antichrist is. He's got a false baptism, making you believe it's the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He's got a false water baptism. Yes, sir. Which is even scriptural. He's got all that thing just enough to impersonate, to be cunning and slick. Watch where it comes out of. Right there where it started. Right in there. Comes out on this other side over here. Then he said you had just a little light, Luther. Then along come Wesley. And how it was in his age, he began to brighten up. Then it was between that age and the last age, he set an open door. He set an open door for those who would come in. Then he said she went on off into lukewarm condition, and he spurred it from his mouth, tucked the remnant, resurrection come, and away he went. That's right. There it is, standing in the seven golden candlesticks. Now, unto the church of Ephesus, write these things. Write these things which saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works. Remember, they're not forgotten. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and thou cannot bear them which are evil. And we just put up with anything that's evil and call it religion. Oh, well, they go. We go to church. We're as good as the rest of the fellas. Go right home. Stay home on Wednesday night. Watch the television. The very pits of hell. Try, go right out and listen to the picture show to the drive. It's too hot to go to show it even to the church. And even the preacher closes up through the midst of the summer. He says it's too hot to go to church. It's not be too bad to go to hell, brother. You'll go someday they were hotter than that. You better listen. How can you? Brother, you couldn't make a dove eat a dead horse if you had to. He couldn't do it. His nature's different. A dove ain't got no gall. He can't digest it. And a man that's born again of the Spirit of God cannot eat those things. He can't tolerate it out of his mind. He can't do it. He can't. You're no birds of a feather flock together. And today the world and the church is so much alike you. They talk alike, they drink alike, they smoke alike, they cuss alike, they dress alike, they act alike, and you can't tell one from the other. And yet you're supposed to be sealed by the Holy Spirit. That's all for strong, brother. But I tell you, it'll give you life.
Amen.
The fellow one time went up to a bunch of preachers where they had a seminary called the School of Prophets. One of them said, "Put on the big pot now. We're going to have some dinner." Said Elijah, "Come up. A man's really got a double potion." So one of the fellows went out to pick some peas, and he got a lap full of green gourds and put them in the pot and began to boil it up. Why, they started eating. He said there's death in the pot. That's just about like some of these seminaries could cook up to. That's right. Said there's death in the pot. Elijah said, "Wait a minute. We'll take care of that." He goes and gets a handful of meal and throws it in, so that changed things. Meal, a meal offering. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and forever. Bird, ground, the same for the meal offering. And it made the difference. Can't stand them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say that they are preachers or apostles. And they are not, and hast found them to be liars. That's what he said. I never said it. I'm just quoting him. But you know what God requires? God requires the baptism of the Holy Spirit or you're lost. And a man who up here has a couple of DDDs and LDs and PhDs and
bachelor's degree and everything else behind that, and sometimes knowing more about God than nothing. That's true. Brother, that don't mean anything, but the whole world say, well, our minister is a doctor of divinity. Oh, mercy. That don't have more to do with God than taking a drink of water. Not as much. That's right. God don't care how many PhDs or DDs and you know what the Bible calls, now this is not a joke, because I don't believe in telling, but the Bible calls DD dead dog. That's exactly what the Bible said it was, dead dog. All right, so you can't bark. So that's, all right. And has bore and has patience, and for my name's sake. Oh, I want to grind that in. So you're going to get that in a few nights, God willing. Has labored and has not fainted. You stayed right with it. All right. Notice, nevertheless, I have some things against thee. Ah, here's where I have to leave off now for a little bit. I get this right here so we catch tomorrow night. Have a few things against thee because thou hast left thy first love. What's the matter with the tabernacle? A man ought to be able to say when you meet a man, is your Christian experience, when was the dearest to you? You ought to be able to say, right now. Well, my best experience is back when I first got the baptism of the Holy Spirit. When I come, I said, oh, brother, you've fallen from grace. That's right. Look, has left thy first love, showing that they had something in the beginning and has left it. Not he that beginneth, but he that endureth to the end, the same shall be saved.
Amen.
Not he always saith, Lord, Lord, but the one that doeth the will of my Father. Oh, let me just let that soak just a few minutes. I'm talking fast tonight anyhow. So let that soak just a few minutes. He that doeth the will of my Father. He that endureth to the end. He that endureth, if somebody says, I believe you, that guy's a little hypocrite. Well, if you think that about me, I'll leave church. I won't have no more to do with it. All right, there you are. Shows what you're made out of. Brother, if it's a wheat to begin with, it'll be a wheat at the end. You just never stayed long enough down here. You never make the thing right. That's right. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen. Go back and remember when you used to have experience where you wouldn't talk about nobody. Anything went wrong in the church, you didn't sit on your neighbor's steps over there and talk about the church and talk about everybody else. Fly loose and go join another church. No, you stayed right there patiently and prayed it out. God brought it on through. See? Remember from which thou art fallen and repent. You know what repent means, don't you? And do thy first work. Go back and get your first experience. Do the things you did in the beginning. Go up the altar and make it right with God, in other words. That's right. Do thy first work, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and I will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. Mm-hmm. If you don't, you'll have a broke-up church and gone to pieces. Lest thou repent. But this thou, oh, now here we come. Hold tight, listen close, keep your ecclesiastical vest on now, and take your umbrella down. Listen. For but this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. You hate the deeds of a Nicolaitan. Now what? What was deeds in Ephesus? In the next church age was the doctrine. We're going to pick that up tomorrow night. The Nicolaitans. And he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Now, the next verse starts in with the Samaritan church. Now, Nicolaitans. That's where we're going to start with tomorrow night, taking out of Revelation 13. The Nicolaitan priesthood began right there in Ephesus. And that before that church age failed, in 300 years of its existence, before it went out of existence, the Nicolaitans began to start up a doctrine, a priesthood of brethren. And then the first that come from Nicholas, which was one of in Acts the 6th chapter, I believe in the 5th verse, where he went and chose out the deacons. And they took this one, which was a Nicholas there, and started from there and called it the Nicolaitan, and begin to organize a priesthood, and from there it become a deed, what they were doing, saying these things on confessions and so forth, and then it become a doctrine over here, and went into Babylon and ended up down here at the last time with all Christianity wrapped around it. Just a little remnant to be saved out of it. Watch and see what it is tomorrow night, if God being willing. Oh, my dear brother, my dear sister, to Him that's able to keep you from falling, to Him that's able to hold your heart in grace, may He shed His blessings upon you. May you never forget that we're living in the last days of the last church age, or it's predicted to be a lukewarm church age, just half-hearted about it, and stop being half-hearted. Really come to Christ with all your heart. I ain't telling you what church to join. That don't have... God will never ask you that in the judgment.
Amen.
No, sir, He don't care what church you go. He wants you. It's an individual. And you must be born again and receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit or you're gone. See? You're just playing church. You're just impersonating until you actually have an experience of being born again. And there are Him that stood there and the seven golden candlesticks through the seven church ages. And the same Holy Spirit that lit the church there lights it over here. Now, there's been impersonators in that church, and this, the Nicolaitans there, and all down through every church age impersonators, till it gets down here until it's just got to one great big conglomeration of organization. And God kicks the whole thing out and takes the remnant of the people to glory. May the Lord bless you. This is kind of rough, friends, but it's good. It'll help you and keep you from falling. Now, don't go around and say, Brother Branham threw it off on my church. It wasn't meant for any church. It was only meant to you as an individual. I don't. If you belong to the Baptist church, then you'd be a real Holy Ghost-filled Baptist. Amen. If you belong to the Methodist church, be a real Holy Ghost-filled Methodist. Whatever
Amen.
It is. And you'll not be an indebtedness. You'll be a credit to any church or any neighborhood
Amen.
For the glory of God.
Amen.
May the Lord bless you now while we stand, if you will.
Amen.
Dear Master of life, after reading your word, we stand in awe, realizing that someday this reading tonight will be, we'll hear it on the tape recording as it was at the day of judgment. What are we going to do about it? Seeing that we're living in this last age, darkness everywhere. What a time. See the coming of the Lord, signs appearing, great tidal waves are rolling. Man's heart failing, fear, perplexed the time, distress between the nations. Many say, oh, I've heard that for years, but did not the Scripture say they'd say that? There's no difference in the times when our fathers fell asleep. Not knowing that we're right on the threshold. He may come before morning. And Father, what day or what hour do we know that this little brittle threads of life we're walking on will break from beneath us? And our poor souls will hang out in the balance on the Word of God. And our attitudes of what we have heard and read, it behooves us, Lord, to stop now and check ourselves. While men and women, boys or girls, standing here in this little audience tonight, sane and sound, may they think deeply just now. If they have not yet been born again, may they purpose in their heart right now, I'll never eat or drink until you fill me with the same manna that you fill them with at the day of Pentecost. Until the world becomes dead, and everything secondarily but Thee, my Lord. And the love for everything else will fade. But take all the love of the world from me, and let me from this day be wholly Thine. Grant it, Lord. Be with the people as they go to their homes. Remember the needy. Oh God, the poor in our land. The poor in spirit. Those that are hungering. God, raise up ministers everywhere, fill them with the Holy Spirit, and send them forth preaching, Lord, like firebrands. We don't know what hour. We only pass this way once. We're only mortal once. And thanks be to God for that. But the next life, we'll not preach the gospel in the next life that is to come, but we'll rejoice in the gospel with them of the ages who's accepted it, with the head captain, our Lord Jesus, who's all worthy, and all praise be to him forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. Turn and shake hands with each other while we sing, Blessed be the tie that binds.
Blessed be the tie.
It's just 10 minutes. The time for the lights now is on relaying. Y'all shake hands, go home, rejoice, and come back tomorrow night at 7:30 exactly. We'll begin the service, God willing.